Alright, welcome to another video, and before we get started, I'd like to take a quick minute to thank all the Patreon supporters and YouTube channel members whose names you see scrolling across the screen right now. They make this financially possible, and without you, I probably wouldn't be here making videos, so thank you. Alright, so today we're going to be taking a look at the ZOHD Altus, as you can see there sitting on the bench. Now, I do realize I'm a little bit late for my review. There are several channels that have already reviewed the airplane. But I've kind of been working at it when I could, had a few roadblocks along the way. No fault of the airplane, just some other stuff getting in the way that we'll talk about during this video. But it's just, we'll do a quick rundown of the build real quick, and then we'll get on to some flying and my experiences with it so far. So as you can see, I do have the plug-and-play version that includes the ZOHD branded motors. These are 2204 1870 kV motors. Now you might notice I'm running these two-bladed props here. I went with a 6x4. They did include these HQ props. They're three-bladed 5x4 if I remember right. But you can see there, if I sit one onto the motor shaft, kind of line it up where it would be mounted on the plane, it's going to contact the ground when you're landing. There's just no way to avoid it. And because I land in grass out here, I tend to prefer props that kind of get up out of the way a little better. So I went with these two-bladed props that you can see here. And like I said, these are three-blade 5x4 that they included. So I went with a two-bladed 6x4, just some that I had on hand just to kind of stay in the ballpark. Servos are what was included with the airplane. They came with the linkages already made up. And surprisingly, all the linkages for, well, the tail is a direct drive setup. There's no horns. The I'd have to flip it over to show it to you. I'll do that in a minute. But the tail servos, they just kind of key directly into the surfaces with no linkages. So you can't really adjust the travel or anything. Or I guess really not even centering other than splines on the servo arm. But those were all centered up well as the aileron servos. I didn't have to touch the linkages at all. And I only needed a couple of milliseconds of trim. If I remember right, it was like 1490 something on all the surfaces. So I was pretty impressed with that. Just out of the box, those were all done. Now I did limit the aileron travel to, I think, 80% travel in INAV, and I actually picked that up from Painless360's video, or maybe it was Andrew Newton, one of the two. I watched both of their reviews. This airplane was actually delayed in arriving to me, besides the other issues that we'll talk about later. It took a while to get here. I actually thought it was lost in shipping and kind of gave up on it at one point, and I started watching other people's reviews anyway, not thinking that I was going to review it myself. So I did pick up a couple of hints like that from those videos, and I'll put a link to both of those down below. And there are several others you can find if you search, but I did watch those, so I'll give them credit where credit is due. I'll link to them, and I do recommend you go check them both out because they're probably both better reviews than mine are. But anyway, getting back to this one. Another thing I picked up from Lee from Painless360, this front mount for a walk snail. It's slightly modified a bit. He used a V1 transmitter, and this one has a single antenna V2 that you can see kind of tucked away hiding in there, and I'll put some more pictures up on the screen as well. And there's a pro camera mounted in here. I just modified his design a little bit, and I'll put a link to his design on Thingiverse. I'm not sure if I'll post this one. I might as a remix. It's only slightly modified to match the mounting pattern of the V2. Camera mount's unchanged. But it does include a nose that kind of snaps on there with some magnets for a more streamlined fit that holds just a fixed camera, which would be the way to go if you're going a fixed camera with analog video. With HD, you do kind of need some extra cooling for the transmitter like that. But I don't really like this blunt nose. I'm not a fan of it. It was a quick and easy solution. But I think if I was going to fly this one a lot, I would either try to make a more streamlined mount for it or replace this with something that would hold a pen servo, because I do like pen servos. If you watch my channel, you know that. But anyway, that's how I have that mounted in it. And one of the crashes that we're going to talk about yet here in a bit, because I have actually crashed this airplane once. Actually damaged it and repaired it. I'll show you that in a minute. But this is the first printed mount, and you can see it's actually broken. It's kind of all crushed and broken. The battery actually tried to come through and push the camera and transmitter through the printed piece. And so they kind of took the brunt of all that force. And the printed mount kind of
worked as a shock absorber, I guess. But it kind of took some of that load out. There was, so getting onto that crash, I actually had decided to try out auto launch in iNav, because I am running iNav on this. We'll get to some of the electronics here in a bit. But I decided to try out the latest stable version of iNav. It's a 7.1.0 that I'm running on here. And I did a maiden flight and just launched normally like I always did previously when I was flying iNav before getting into autopilot stuff. I always launched in angle mode with a bit of up elevator mixed on my radio so that it just kind of climbed out straight and level. Well, not level, but a straight climb out. And that's how I launched this one for the maiden flight. And it went fine, and I just kind of decided while I was trying new things, trying some of the new iNav stuff, I decided to finally give iNav auto launch a go. And I thought I set it all up. Well, I did set it all up right. I just didn't use it properly. I put auto launch on a switch and armed the airplane, then enabled auto launch and threw the airplane, so it wasn't actually in auto launch. And I didn't realize that. With iNav auto launch on a switch, you need to enable auto launch before you arm the airplane, and then arm the airplane while the auto launch is enabled, and it will start the process like that. So that was my fault. I threw the airplane, it kind of flew about 20 feet ahead of me and nosed into the ground pretty hard, like I said, hard enough for the battery to try to come out the front and broke the printed mount. Luckily, it didn't hurt any of the walk snow gears. Like I said, I do have a nice V2 transmitter and a pro camera in there, and I would have been sad if I broke those, but I didn't, thankfully. But what it did do is, if you look right under here, try to get my camera aligned right. I'm filming this with my phone, so I do apologize for some of the framing and stuff like that. But if you look right there carefully, you can see there's a crack in the foam that's been repaired, and that crack continues under the motor nacelle, this molded plastic piece. It continues under there back into where it kind of splits the foam. There's a hole in it there. And there was another little bit of damage out here somewhere, and some more back here that you can't really see once they've been glued together. This wing kind of caught the ground and tried to twist around the spar and cracked like that. So I glued that all back together, and if you notice, the wings are laminated. You know that shiny glossy finish on the wings. I didn't do the fuselage or the tail, but I did laminate both wings after the crash. For the maiden flight, they were not laminated, and then the subsequent flight after the crash, they were. But I mainly did that just to have a little bit more confidence, had a little more strength back in this wing. Like I said, it's cracked where the spar tried to come up through the foam. But other than that, there was no damage. It didn't damage the fuselage or anything. This wing sustained no damage. Just right over there, it cracked it a little bit and was an easy repair. And I kind of like the laminated look better anyway. And the decals stick better to the laminated stuff anyway. This is another thing Andrew had mentioned in his review, that these leading edge decals, there's one down both leading edge there of each wing, they didn't stick well to the foam on his. So I actually left them off of mine, and I wasn't going to use them until after I went ahead and laminated the wings, and I figured they'll stick now a lot better. So I went ahead and put them on, and I ran my sealing iron over them too to kind of seal them down. So they're on there really good now. I don't think they're going anywhere. But that's pretty much it. So I guess we'll go ahead and remove the hatches and talk about some of the gear inside the airplane at this point. Let's remove the front hatch first. And you can see I'm running a 4S1P21700 pack, the ZOHD branded pack. It's a 5,000 milliamp hour. And with it slid right up in the nose right here, I can get the center of gravity. And that's with this blunt nose on the front. So with a little bit longer nose, especially if I put a pan servo up here, that would give me room to run either a lighter battery or to slide this battery back, obviously. But if you want to run a heavier battery, you can. I mean, obviously this one works fine, but you can also run a heavier battery. There's a fair bit of room back in here to slide it back before you get into the spar. The spar runs kind of around the back of the GPS right in here. And again, I do apologize for this, the weird framing, not used to filming with this. But as it sits, as I've flown it here, I don't remember the exact weight right offhand. I know it's 900 and something grams, pretty close to 1 kilograms. which is a little bit heavier than I would have liked. It feels heavy anyway. Before I flew it, I thought it was going to fly heavy. It was going to be a porky little airplane. But it actually flies fine in the air. I think part of that can be attributed to the airfoil and the wings. The wings are under-cambered a little bit, so they're a high-lift airfoil, which allows it to handle the weight just fine. But that means it's always going to be best suited to a cruiser, pretty much. It's not really going to be an aerobatic kind of proximity flying plane. It's not going to be good for that. Just for the simple fact that the wings are under cambered, that's going to not be suited for it, really. But anyway, moving back to the GPS, I'll remove the little cover there. The GPS in here is currently a BN220. I was going to put a Walksnail M10 GPS in here, which I actually did put it in here. But I had issues with it. It seems flaky. It doesn't want to lock and everything. I think it might be a faulty GPS. So I had this one laid around a spare and went ahead and just put that in it. And it worked fine just to get it in the air. One thing of note, though, if you use a GPS with a compass, these two magnets in the hatch here, and of course the accompanying magnets in the bottom of this hatch, they're going to interfere with the compass. It's going to be a problem. You'll probably need to move the compass somewhere else. And the rear hatch also has two magnets in the back here and accompanying in the hatch. So you can't really move it back here close to the tail boom either. You would need to move the compass either way up in the nose up front somewhere, or I don't know, maybe out on a wing or something. There is a couple of pockets in the bottom of the wing that I have filled with little foam plugs. Can't really show them to you anyway because I have them laminated over now. But you could either move it way out here on the tail or way up in the nose or out on one of the wing tips if you really need it to use a compass. I typically like using a compass with my Ardu plane bills. I've never used a compass in INAV. And it's, even with Ardu plane, it's absolutely not necessary. It kind of adds a little bit extra layer of precision as far as heading and flying crosswinds and things like that. You'll notice a little bit of difference, but you're going to be 100% fine flying without a compass, and that's how I intend to do this one. It's just not worth the hassle to work around the magnet issue. But just be aware, there is magnets near the compass, near the GPS, so if you have a GPS with a compass, it's going to be a problem. So moving back, you can see my flight controller right in there. It's kind of covered up with the capacitor. I have it sitting on top, just kind of piggybacked on it. But this is the Speedy B F405 Wing Mini. And you can see my ESC wires. They do come terminated with XT60 connectors, and there's a Y lead in the box. But I chose to cut those connectors off and just solder them straight to the ESC board as intended, or as normal, like I typically do. Just for a little bit cleaner build. And then my battery lead runs out to the front. Nothing too exciting there. As far as the flight controller, pretty standard stuff. And the receiver is an Express LRS one. It's a RP3. I think this is a V2, if I remember right. It's a Radio Master Diversity 2.4 GHz ELRS receiver. And it's just kind of sitting up here. And I cut some little slits in the foam and stuck the antennas, one on either side there. They're both upright, as you can see, and I do realize that some of the benefit you can get from diversity receivers is running them in like 90 degrees to each other, like in a V formation. But for a cruiser, I like having my antennas vertical, and I figured I would get the benefit of having one on each side so that they are relatively small antennas, as you can see, so you can easily shadow one with a motor or with the batteries and things in the front like that. So I figured having one on each side of the fuselage, I would always have one out readily available and not being shadowed by any other electronics. So that's what I decided to do with them for now. And it was quick and easy. And this little lead here, this is just a little remote USB and buzzer board for the flight controller. I just kind of have it tucked away in here in front of the spar like that. It just kind of rides right there right now until I figure out what to do with it. I can glue it down somewhere, but then the USB port isn't as easily accessible, so I may make a little clip or something for it to snap into, or I can remove it when I need to use it. But anyway, that's the electronics, and everything else is all stuff that was included with the plug and play. And forgive the thunder, I'm not sure if you can hear that, but there's a thunderstorm going on outside right now, which is why I'm able to record this today. But yeah, like I said, I was going to show you the tail servos. You can see, well, you can't really see them, but you can see the servo horn and the little bump in the foam there. There's a servo embedded in the black foam there. And that plastic piece here is actually part of the servo horn, and it keys into the elevon. So there's no linkage top or bottom. They're just kind of direct drive off of the servos, and the servo shaft is in line with the hinge, which makes for a really clean setup. You can kind of see right there how it works. It's a really clean and no slop setup, and it works well. I was a little bit worried that the control throws might not be right, because there's really nothing you can do to adjust them, but they seem to be pretty spot on. Elevator and rudder both feel fine using the default 50-50 mix in iNav, so I just kind of left it at that. And the aileron servos, we flip one over here, you can see it's laminated over, but normally that hole is open to the bottom, but I decided to go ahead and leave the laminate and just kind of seal that hole up. But you can see the servo is just kind of fits in the bottom of the wing there, and they have the control horns and linkages on top, which I guess is to keep them up out of harm's way with when landing, but that kind of begs the question, if they're that concerned about the linkages, why did they ship it with three-bladed props? But anyway, like I said, I recommend two-bladed props anyway. But yeah, they do include nice ball linkages and little machine screws with nylock nuts, so I'm really happy to see that. There's no slop at all in it. And like I said, they were all centered up and adjusted properly out of the packaging. About the only thing we haven't talked about is the motor mounts. The motor mounts are mounted to some little, either, I'm not sure if they're carbon fiber or fiberglass, but there's some type of little fiber plates here that the motor is screwed to, then that little plate screws onto the motor nacelle. And if you look on the bottom, the plastic piece, there's four screws in it. And forgive, they're kind of dirty right now from where last time I landed in the grass. But they, you take those four screws out, and this little plastic molded piece will split in half and separate out of the foam. And there's actually some threaded brass inserts. I think they're brass, they're gold colored. But there's some threaded metal inserts that these little screws thread into in the plastic. And these are built like super solid. They're built like a tank. You're not going to have any trouble with those. I really doubt you're ever going to break them or anything like that. Pretty happy with that. And I like the fact that they include this little, you see this wing shows counterclockwise rotation, and this one over here will show, if I can frame it in the camera right, will show clockwise rotation. So you got clockwise and counterclockwise. And that puts the top of your prop spinning in, the way I like to set my twins up. But ironically, out of the box, the motors and ESCs were wired on this one so that they rotated the opposite direction of what I think they should be and what's indicated on the motor mounts. I was actually going to just resolder the wires. I cut the heat shrink back on one of the ESCs and had my iron hot ready to solder it up. But I noticed on the bottom of the wing, you see there's these little plastic plates. And again, this is laminated over right now. But there's some little plastic plates right here that kind of stick down where all your connections are made. I popped one of those off. I just kind of, they're glued on, like stuck on with adhesive. And I peeled one back. And there's two bullet connectors for the power leads to the ESC. The ESC rides in this little bottom half of this mount, in fact. But there's two bullet connectors under here for the positive and negative leads to the ESC. And a servo connector for the signal lead. So if you peel these white covers off, there's one on each side, one in each wing for all your connections on each side. If you peel that off, you can actually unplug the motor and ESC, or, well, the speed controller and the motor comes with it. So I actually did that. I just opened up the motor mounts and peeled those white plates off and just swapped the motors around so I didn't have to actually resolder anything so that they rotate the right direction. So that was just a little minor hiccup that I ran into. But so the real problems came when I went to fly it. Like I said, the first flight I made, the maiden flight, was in about a 20 mile an hour wind because I had this thing built and ready to fly, and the wind just wouldn't let up. The weather didn't cooperate at all. So finally, I just kind of got impatient and decided to maiden it in a 20-mile-an-hour wind, which went fine. It actually handled the wind fine. It was obviously getting tossed around and thrown around. It was a pretty gusty wind, too. But I went ahead and flew it, and it went fine. But like I said, I couldn't really do anything other than run the auto trim and let it trim the servos. That's when I found all the surfaces were actually centered up pretty good. And just verify that everything worked. So it was way too rough and gusty to do an auto tune or anything like that. So I made a quick flight like that and decided to quit while I was ahead and save it for a better day. And then that next flight, the attempted second flight, was when I screwed up the auto launch, and that was totally my fault, and I broke it. So I had to reprint this nose piece here and repair the wing and then go ahead and laminate them. And I got it ready for a third attempt, well, for another attempt at a second flight. But the third day I had it out, we had some pretty decent weather. I think it was around 5 miles an hour or so, but it was a real smooth wind. It wasn't gusty at all. So I took it up and did my auto tune and did a little bit of acro fly and actually auto tuned in acro and kind of felt the airplane out and everything was good and I was pretty happy with it. And then I discovered another pressing issue. When I was testing return to launch, for some reason the barometer, I think the fault is on the flight controller. I think I have a bad barometer on here. I never noticed it on the first flight, but on the second flight, while in return to launch mode, the altimeter started counting up like crazy, started just ramping up, and the flight controller pushed the nose down trying to lose the altitude that it thought it had, and it was actually going to, if I were to let it go, it would have just drove the airplane into the ground. So I dropped back into, I think, angle mode, and just got out of a navigation mode, and everything was fine. I just kind of manually flew it around and watched the altimeter count up to like 750 something feet or close to that, 740 something. I don't remember the exact number right now, but I was obviously not that high. I was down, 50 feet max. And it eventually started bleeding off and got back down close to normal. So I continued on and I did a few more return to launch sequences, let it work. Everything was fine. Flew in cruise mode a bit, everything was fine. Then later on in the flight, I switched to cruise mode again, and a few moments after I switched into cruise mode, the altimeter started going crazy again, started counting up, and it was going to drive the airplane back down to the ground. So again, I left a navigation mode, went back to angle, and flew it a bit, and watched the altitude settle and get back to normal. And I flew it for a few more minutes, and everything was fine. It was even pretty well close to zero. I think it was about 1 foot off of being perfect when I landed at the end of the flight, so I'm not sure what the deal is with that. Like I said, I suspect probably a faulty barometer in the flight controller, but I can't really rule it out one way or the other. And yes, it would be easy to just say, oh, it's INAV fault, it's an INAV bug. But there's too many people flying 7.1.0 and not experiencing this for me to call it like that. And in other words, I'm saying I don't know. I mean, you know as much as I do about it at this point. The next step would be either to replace the flight controller, and I did reach out to SpeedyB and showed them the clip of it happening and asked if they would provide me another flight controller so I can swap it out and roll that out. Whether they send it or not, I guess I could still put ArduPilot on this one just to rule out an INAV bug, or maybe fall back to like 6.0 or 6.1 or whatever, an earlier version of INAV. But like I said, I don't think it's an INAV bug because I think it would have been caught by now. I'm kind of leaning toward the flight controller. That's why I asked them to replace it. But we'll see. If I figure it out later, I'll give you an update or whatever. But anyway, I'm going to leave you with a little bit of the rest of the footage when I wasn't having issues, just kind of so you can kind of see how the airplane flies. But like I said, I am late to reviewing this one, and there's already some other good reviews. A couple of them I've linked to below the video here. But nonetheless, I'll have my usual affiliate links below this one. If you do want to order one and you feel like giving back without it costing you any extra, you can use that. But this will be an affiliate link to Banggood, who did supply me with this kit for review, well, the plug and play variant for review. Obviously, all the other stuff was mine that I already had or purchased to build it. But anyway, check your local retailers, because these have had time to show up in the U.S. by now. So you'll probably, if you're in the United States or whatever the part of the world you're from, check your local retailers first. So it'll be a little bit quicker than ordering international. But anyway, thank you for watching the video. It's been going on pretty long and not terribly informative. Hopefully entertaining, but I guess if you're still watching, it must have been. So thank you for that, and keep an eye out for what's to come, and I will hopefully see you all more regularly on a more regular basis in the future. So keep an eye out for that, and I will see you all then.